Venn diagrams bring up some interesting issues about categorical statements, but more to the point, we can use similar diagrams to assess logical relationships and arguments. A certain type of argument is of special interest to us. It's called a categorical syllogism. Here's an example of a categorical syllogism. All ninjas are badasses, and no actors are ninjas. Therefore, no actors are badasses. A categorical syllogism has two premises and a conclusion. There are three terms. Term is a word or phrase that denotes a set. In this case, the terms are ninjas, badasses, and actors. One of the terms appears in both premises. It's called the middle term. In this case, it's ninjas. Meanwhile, each of the other terms appears in one of the premises and as one of the terms in the conclusion. We want to name them, so we're going to call the subject of the conclusion the minor term, and the predicate of the conclusion we call the major term. We call the premise containing the major term the major premise, and the one containing the minor term is the minor premise. To handle a categorical syllogism, we need a Venn diagram for three sets, as there are three terms. Start with the two-set diagram, then draw a third circle in the middle, partially overlapping the other two. It wouldn't matter if we placed it below the others, but uniformity helps to keep things simple, so let's always put it here, like it is in the book. We end up with eight regions. Let me clarify something about this. We purposefully draw the diagram this way in order to generate the correct eight regions. It's not like drawing the circles is a way of discovering the regions. Each time you introduce a new set, there's a yes-no question for any item within the universe. Is it in that set or out of it? So, for one set, we divide the universe into two parts. For two sets, divide it into four parts. And for three, into eight parts. Each time you add a new set, you're cutting the previously existing regions, each of them, into two parts. This is the same pattern we saw with truth tables, wherein for each simple statement, the yes-no question was true or false. So the number of assignments increased by powers of two. If we wanted a diagram for four sets, we would need 16 regions, then 32, and so on. It can be done, but eventually the shapes can't be circles. They have to snake around in these weird ways to divide up the regions. They also get pretty cluttered. It would be difficult to use a Venn diagram for four or five sets. Luckily, we're always dealing with categorical syllogisms, so we only ever need three. We need to label the circles. It will help simplify things if we all label things in a systematic way. Make the left circle represent the minor term, in this case, actors, and make the right circle the major term, in this case, badasses. Now, take a minute to examine the diagram and think about what each region represents. Region 3 might be the easiest. Remember, there's no information on the diagram at this point. It just divides up the universe. Region 3 is the possibly empty intersection of all three sets. It represents ninja badasses who are also actors, or badass actors who are also ninjas. That is, if there are any such things, this is where they would have to be. Now for region 4, see if you can predict what it represents. It's in the intersection of ninjas and badasses, so you might have said ninja badasses. But remember, there are three things you can say about any region. Region 4 is also outside the set of actors, so it has to be ninja badasses who specifically are not actors. And region 2? Actors who are ninjas, but not badasses. And region 1 is ninjas who are not badasses, and also not actors. You should cycle through the rest of the regions and determine for yourself what each one represents. Okay, now it's time to evaluate the argument. There are two steps to the procedure. First, we represent the premises. Think about what it means for an argument to be valid. The information in the premises already includes the information in the conclusion. So once you've faithfully represented the premises in diagram form, if the argument is valid, it will automatically represent the conclusion too. Therefore, the second step is to ask whether that has happened. The question is, does this diagram force the conclusion to be true? If so, then the argument is valid, and if not, it's invalid. Remember, the diagram only intentionally represents the premises. Don't get into a diagramming frenzy and draw the conclusion in there too. That would ruin the test. Any argument would look valid, but not because it is, because you drew the conclusion on the diagram. Let's complete the diagram. The first premise is all ninjas are badasses. If we were diagramming that statement alone, it would be easy enough. We put the subject on the left and the predicate on the right, and then shade subject minus predicate. In this case, though, the subject and predicate are not oriented in the same way. They might be reversed or they might be arranged diagonally. Also, corresponding to each region on the two-set diagram, there are two regions on the three-set diagram, as noted previously. There are several ways to visualize or find the correct area. You can think of it as ignoring the circle that isn't mentioned. This premise doesn't mention actors, so we just pretend that circle isn't there. Or just remember that we want the part of the subject that's outside the predicate. So it's here, regions 1 and 2. Make a note of the shape. It's like a half moon. And let me point out a common mistake. Some people have a tendency to want to leave the unmentioned circle alone. I guess because they're thinking, this premise has nothing to do with, in this case, actors. So it must not affect that circle. However, that's a mistake. When I say that all ninjas are badasses, that does have implications for actors. It means that no actor can be a ninja unless he or she is also a badass. If you prefer not to think in terms of a picture, you could also list the regions within the subject set and then remove all those that are also within the predicate set. Hopefully some combination of these methods will work for you, and it becomes easy after a bit of practice to identify the region standing for subject minus predicate. Anyhow, we shade that. That indicates that the area originally dedicated to ninjas who are not badasses is empty. Our next premise says that no actors are ninjas, which is an E statement. Let's compare it with an E statement diagram when we have one statement. We need to shade the intersection of the two sets. Once again, the orientation is a little different, but it's easy enough to find the intersection of actors and ninjas. It's the zone composed of both regions 2 and 3. So we shade that. Now, stop diagramming. One of the most common errors I see is that students just continue to diagram the conclusion too. But if the argument is valid, what the conclusion says should already be forced by the diagram of the premises. So we ask, does this diagram force the conclusion to be true? The conclusion is that no actors are badasses. So in terms of the diagram, we're looking to see if the intersection of actors and badasses is forced to be empty. That is, regions 3 and 6. Is that area, which I'm now outlining, forced to be empty? No. Although 3 is empty, 6 is blank. It could be empty, but there could also be something there. There could be an actor who is a badass. They just couldn't be a ninja too. So the argument is invalid. If any possibility for the conclusion to be false remains after representing the premises, then the argument is invalid. So that's how you diagram a categorical syllogism involving only A statements and E statements. In other words, the universal statements. When you have a syllogism that involves I statements and O statements, the particular statements, a complication arises. So we'll turn to that in the next video.